So for Expedition 3536, I'm just going to give you some brief highlights of a few select investigations. Overall, we have just in Kibo, Columbus, and Destiny, we'll have over 137 investigations active during Expedition 35 and 36. 80 of those are led by U.S.-funded or U.S.-supported investigators. About 25% of our investigations are sponsored under the declaration of ISS as a national laboratory. This started back in 2005 when we were declared a national laboratory by Congress, and that represents our users that are from other government agencies, commercial companies, the private sector, and nonprofit organizations, so they're not funded by NASA. We're also serving the needs of over 400 investigators from around the world, and those investigators represent 28 different countries. And you saw in the graphic that was up, those colors represented the different disciplines. And so we have biology and biotechnology, earth and space sciences, education and cultural activities, human research focused on human physiology and future exploration, physical sciences, and technology development and demonstration. So with that number of investigations, obviously I can't give you a very detailed rundown of most of them. What I did was select five investigations covering that breadth of disciplines linked to some of our past research results and that are kind of new in this starting up in Expedition 35. So the first I want to talk about is from the biology area, and it's called microbiome. Some recent discoveries over the last few years in the microbial sciences have shown us that bacteria account for basically 10 times more cells in our body than our own cells. So we're outnumbered 10 to 1 everywhere we go by the bacteria that we carry with us. And we know that in space flight, bacteria grow quite differently. We also know that the human immune system is affected significantly. And so what we'll be doing in this project is collecting samples from ISS crew members before, during, and after their missions to the ISS, and also looking at the environment of the ISS and the diet and other aspects, other ways that humans have bacteria come into their systems. And we'll be looking at their stress levels and their immune system function as well. It's important from an exploration perspective because this research will help us predict how long-term space travel, which is basically humans and the microbes that go with us, is going to affect those communities, those ecological communities. But also, it's really important because it's addressing a top recommendation of the National Academies of Sciences last year when they suggested that ISS needed to be developed as a microbial observatory to address some of these new findings that have been made across the scientific community. And so this is one of the first studies that really starts addressing that recommendation. And that's important because of the benefits back here on Earth. If we can understand how microbial communities work and take advantage of the ISS as a relatively isolated environment, there's a lot of basic science and then improvements in health on Earth that we can make. Moving to human physiology, we have a new investigation starting in Expedition 35 called Ocular Health. And this is an important investigation because it builds off a discovery made through our space medicine about 2 years ago. It will be the first experiment to characterize the risk of what we're now calling microgravity-induced visual impairment and intracranial pressure. Essentially, what we've discovered is that some astronauts on orbit, not all of them, but they have real changes in fluid shifts in their bodies, and that leads them to both have changes in their vision and also changes in the pressure in their central nervous system. About 20% of the astronauts that have flown to the International Space Station have reported these kinds of vision changes. So what we're going to be doing is taking detailed scientific measurements. Here you see Sunny having some tomography measurements taken of her eye. You may have had something like this in a doctor's office where you have some anesthetizing eye drops, and then they use that direct contact to tap and actually measure the pressure of the fluid that's inside the eye. You also saw some video of ultrasounds, and here's another instrument being used to characterize the eye. So we'll be taking systematic measurements to really try and understand this process for the first time. This is an example of why we really need long-duration human spaceflight with multiple crew members to understand all the different effects on the human body. But it's also interesting that this is a process that was not predicted from what we know about human health on Earth. And we even have some results now that have come out that suggest that what we're seeing in astronauts in orbit could link to ways of understanding cardiovascular disease, high blood pressure, and other aspects in people on Earth that might not be quite as healthy as our astronauts are in orbit. So we're really excited to have this important study kicking off. It will take place over about 2 years. Next, I want to shift from human physiology focused on exploration to technology demonstration focused on exploration. And really just yesterday on ISS, we started a study called UBNT, or ultrasonic background noise test. This test is to observe the high frequency noise levels that are background on the International Space Station and develop an understanding of what those noise levels are so that we can then develop a tool to automatically detect leaks. You can think of a leak as having some kind of a hissing noise, and these ultrasonic detectors, and you see a training video here of someone putting the epoxy on one of these detectors and actually attaching it onto the space behind a rack. And basically what the acoustic engineers will be doing is developing a profile of what normal noises are like inside the ISS, and then they'll be able to start developing algorithms to detect abnormal noises, including the kind of noises you might get if there's air leaking through the pressure wall. And so this will be an important advance in the way that we approach spacecraft safety and leak detection for future exploration missions. Next, I'll shift from technology demonstration to a more fundamental physical process, and that is combustion. Last year, we had a really neat discovery in our combustion rack, and based on one of the combustion experiments we were doing, where we were burning very simple fuels, in this case, heptane drops. And this was from an experiment called FLEX. It was the first time that scientists had observed a low temperature, soot-free, cool flame. Now, cool flame sounds kind of strange. A normal flame is about 1400 degrees Celsius, and a cool flame is about 600 degrees Celsius. We have a video to show you from the inside of the combustion rack that shows you what this observation is. So you see the droplet. The droplet's ignited, and you see the burning go on. Then you'll see an extinction where it gets dark, it goes out, but the flame, the burning actually continues. And then in the end, you can see that through a chemiluminescent afterglow that comes back afterwards. And so that's how scientists know that the flame continued to burn. So this has really important applications on Earth, because this is something you just can't study any other way. This kind of droplet staying in one place and being controllable and measurable without having convection drawing a flame upward in the point that we normally see, say, when we're burning a candle on Earth. This is a fundamental property of combustion you can only study in space. And this gives us some insights and some ways to improve internal combustion engines, because this kind of cool flame property, if you can control it better on Earth, would help you to control combustion in a way that could make engines more fuel efficient. The experiment that we'll be starting in Expedition 35 is a follow-on to the FLEX investigation data I just showed you. It's called the Italian Combustion Experiment for Green Air, or ICE-GA for short. And here you can see a picture in front of the combustion rack as a gas bottle is being put in. And it's a collaboration with the Italian Space Agency. Instead of burning things like heptane, decane, or octane, we'll be looking at second and third generation biofuels. Second generation biofuels are, instead of being made from corn or soybeans, they're made from any kind of excess biomass, so they're not competing with food production. And third generation biofuels are the ones that are made from algae. So we'll be testing combustion in the combustion rack using these different biofuels. And this is obviously very applied at getting insights that will help us to improve the efficiency of combustion with biofuels. Finally, I'd like to shift to the earth sciences and talk about an important earth science remote sensing instrument on ISS, the HICO, or Hyperspectral Imager for the Coastal Ocean. You can see a picture of that here out on the, mounted externally on the Kibo laboratory. Hyperspectral data is essentially hundreds of spectral bands instead of just a few like Landsat has. And so this gives you a lot more information about what's being observed and measured on the Earth below the instrument. As of January 1st, this instrument has transitioned from being just a naval research-operated payload for the Naval Research Laboratory to being a facility on the International Space Station. And this opens it up to a wide array of users, both national lab users from other government agencies and the private sector, especially users that are focused on agribusiness and oil exploration. And it also opens the instrument up to more access to our NASA users that are funded by the Science Mission Directorate in studies of the Earth system. So we're excited about that transition. And I wanted to close by showing you one example of what the Environmental Protection Agency has done with hyperspectral data. They had a Pathfinder Innovation Project exploratory grant from their Office of Research and Development at EPA. And this is one of the results of those. This is Pensacola Bay, Florida. And if you see the little red parts of that image, they took data from HICO and they processed it. And those little red areas represent where there's significant nitrogen coming into the bay and causing blooms of algae. And so they use this by combining their in-water measurements with the remote sensing measurements. They've used it to develop a predictive system that they can use for monitoring the water quality in Pensacola Bay. They're now working to expand this to more bays around the Gulf Coast region and even to look at other EPA regions and see if they can extend this. And both the research oceanographers at EPA as well as their Office of Research is continuing to support expanded use. So this is the kind of use of HICO as a national laboratory facility that really benefits our life here on Earth and will also be extended to additional users because of HICO becoming an ISS facility. So that summary really just touches the surface. I urge you to look at the press kit on nasa.gov to see all of those hundreds of investigations going on. And we look forward to a really dynamic and active research expedition.